Marijuana, the dried leaves and flowers of the Indian hemp weed, is used in the form of a cigarette. Marijuana smoking, experts point out, can make a helpless addict of its victim within weeks, causing physical and moral ruin and death. Should you ever be confronted with the temptation of taking that first puff of a marijuana cigarette, don't do it.
Smoking pot. It fascinates and then assassinates and then it kills. A drug epidemic that's sweeping our nation. Anything to get a kick. Anything to get a blast. Anything to bomb his mind. Quit playing games with God.
Although people around the world have been smoking marijuana for thousands of years, the custom only reached the United States at the beginning of the 20th century when it arrived in the Southwest with a wave of Mexicans looking for work.
Pipe plays. Next.
To these poor laborers, smoking marijuana was a way to relax after a long day of working in the fields. But white Americans along the border didn't much like these foreigners or their strange customs. Marijuana, it was rumored, gave the Mexicans superhuman strength and turned them into bloodthirsty murderers. One evening in El Paso, some white Texans were allegedly attacked by a Mexican that went crazy on the killer weed. Moving swiftly, the El Paso City Council passed a law banning possession of marijuana. Supposedly designed to control marijuana, the law quickly became a way for the city to control Mexicans. Unlike the people of El Paso, most Americans had never even heard of marijuana. They were more concerned about the rising addiction to opium, morphine, cocaine, and heroin, which were all serious public health issues. But instead of treating drug addiction as a public health problem, The federal government put control of these drugs in the hands of the Treasury Department, who created the Federal Bureau of Narcotics.
Rolling!
This is Harry J. Anslinger, Commissioner of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics.
The Treasury Department intends to pursue a relentless warfare against the despicable dope-peddling vulture who preys on the weakness of his fellow man.
America's first drug czar was Harry J. Anslinger. A law and order evangelist, Anslinger would shape America's attitude toward marijuana for generations to come. Like many Americans, Anslinger was a prohibitionist. These morally correct citizens sincerely felt that progress could only be achieved by controlling the depraved impulses of the masses.
Swordfish.
He believed that if the laws were tough enough, America could be rid of alcohol. Put enough people in jail, and eventually the public will learn to behave. And he applied this same philosophy to mounting the government's war on drugs.
Special Treasury agents are part of a massive force created solely to control the traffic in narcotics.
You got any merchandise obtained in Canada or abroad?
No.
Have you any liquor?
No.
Get out of the car and let's take a look at it. Come on.
Move over, J. Edgar Hoover. Here come the agents of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics.
Like J. Edgar Hoover, Anslinger posed for the cameras, creating the impression he was smashing one major dope ring after another. But he found out pretty quickly that policing 48 states on a depression-strapped budget was impossible. His solution was to try to convince the states to police local drug traffic themselves. Campaigning tirelessly, he lobbied each state to sign a joint agreement to commit state resources to fighting drugs. But only 9 states signed on. The other 39 viewed it as federal interference in their affairs. It was a major defeat for the young drug commissioner, but he wasn't the type to give up. Meanwhile, marijuana, carried by West Indian sailors, arrived in port cities like New Orleans. Known as muggles, tea, or reefer, it was popular with the jazz crowd because it made music sound so good. From here, musicians carried it up the Mississippi to urban centers in the north. With marijuana showing up in the big cities, Anslinger realized it might be the answer to his problem. If he could persuade white America that marijuana was a deadly menace, frightened voters might push their state legislators to sign on to his Uniform Narcotics Act.
Faster. Faster.
plate, Master. I know what you want. You want to kill me.
In this case, the state waives trial of the defendant, Ralph Wiley. It is convinced that he is hopelessly and incurably insane, a condition caused by the drug marijuana to which he was addicted. It is recommended, Your Honor, that the defendant be placed in an institution for the criminally insane for the rest of his natural life.
I see no reason why the request should not be granted.
Wrap your chops round this stick of tea. Blow this game and get high with me.
Determined to get the act passed, Anslinger unleashed a media campaign to make the public believe that this little-known plant growing at the side of rural roads was the biggest threat America had ever faced.
Parents, beware. Your children, homeward bound from school, are being introduced to a new danger in the form of a drugged cigarette, marijuana. A Chicago mother watching her daughter die as an indirect result of marijuana addiction told officers that at least 50 of the girl's young friends were slaves to the narcotic, continuing addiction until they deteriorate mentally, become insane, and turn to violent crime and murder.
Anslinger's campaign was tailor-made for the lurid tabloid press and supported by an army of moralist groups that captured the public's imagination.
Movie Tone News, covering the world to bring you the news.
He's a man that smokes that job will take you for a dive. Wonders if he's still alive when you smoke that killing job.
America is threatened by a new drug menace. Street corner vendors whose stock in trade is the deadly local weed marijuana pass it out in cigarette form. From ingeniously concealed containers, the reefers go to the waiting hands of deluded youngsters.
Police find a city backyard full of dope. This innocent-looking weed is Mexican marijuana, which when smoked produces more nightmares than opium. Captain Mooney of the narcotics squad will tell us something about it.
The constant use of these marijuana cigarettes causes temporary insanity.
Yes, what that kid does.
Let's go, Jack, I'm red hot.
State voted for the Uniform Narcotic Act, and so should yours.
The propaganda campaign was successful beyond Anslinger's wildest dreams. One by one, state after state signed on.
When you smoke that killing job.
Gentlemen, take your seats.
But now, frightened out of their minds, the American public demanded that the federal government pass new laws to fight marijuana. Terrified voters wanted action, and their government responded. Without any public debate, scientific inquiry, or political objection, the Marijuana Tax Act was signed into law by President Roosevelt. The act prohibited possession of marijuana anywhere in the United States without a special tax stamp from the Treasury Department. And the Treasury Department didn't give out any stamps, effectively making marijuana illegal. Overnight, a new class of criminals was created.
To the Treasury agents of the Bureau of Narcotics comes the job of wiping out this traffic. And in 1937, we smashed 10 major narcotic rings. Only the cooperation of an awakened public will make the hell of it.
The latest crave, the country's rave, is jive, jive, jive. This modern treat makes life complete. Jive, jive, jive. All the jive is gone. All the jive is gone. I'm sorry, Kate, but you got here late. All the jive is gone. All the jive is gone. All the jive is gone. So come on in and drink some gin. All the jive is gone.
The first person to be convicted was Samuel R. Caldwell, a 58-year-old Denver man. Sentencing him to 4 years hard labor at Leavenworth, Judge J. Foster Syme said, "I consider marijuana the worst of all narcotics. Under its influence, men become beasts. In the future, I will impose the heaviest penalties. The government is going to enforce this new law to the letter."
Prohibition cannot be enforced for the simple reason that the majority of American people do not want it enforced and are resisting its enforcement. That being so, the orderly thing to do under our form of government is to abolish a law which cannot be enforced, a law which the people of the country do not want enforced.
New York's prohibition-fighting mayor, Fiorello LaGuardia, was somewhat skeptical of the government's claims that marijuana was causing murder, rape, and the destruction of America's youth. Wanting to get the facts, he commissioned a study by a group of 31 impartial scientists. After 6 years of medical and sociological research, the LaGuardia Commission found smoking marijuana did not lead to violent or antisocial behavior. Smoking marijuana did not cause uncontrollable sexual urges. Smoking marijuana did not alter a person's basic personality structure. Item by item, the commission's report disproved every negative effect claimed by Harry Anslinger. Furious, Anslinger used his influence with the press to have the report discredited and destroyed every copy he could get his hands on. And by restricting the supply of marijuana, he put a stop to any further research. Not taking any chances, Anslinger ordered his men to dig up dirt on anyone who disagreed with him. And going on the offensive, he targeted the entertainment industry, which he saw as a degenerate moral influence.
I wait until he was grown. Well, now he's growed and he gets his legacy. Only it's made out of hemp.
Dreamed about a reaper 5 feet long.
Not wanting any trouble with the government, the Hollywood studios agreed to give Anslinger personal control over all movie scripts that mentioned drugs. And movies he felt sent the wrong message were just banned.
The queen of everything.
pranks and jokes, of ice cream cones and chocolate sodas. Youth is a time for getting a job, for finding one's place in the world. But sometimes in these troubled days, the very thoughtlessness of youth has led to a living nightmare, addiction to drugs.
What's that?
H.
H? What's H?
Shh, that's a lot.
It's heroin. Will it make me sick like the reefers did?
Marty's story is like many of the others. It started with marijuana cigarettes.
Come on, it's my turn next. Gee, Duke, where'd you get him?
I know a guy.
Three for a buck.
Let me try.
He was determined to be one of the gang if it killed him. And it almost did. Several weeks later, after smoking reefers, Marty's befogged brain hit on a clever way to open pop bottles. Later, Stan went to the hospital for swallowing broken glass. Marty badly cut the inside of his mouth, though he didn't even know it at the time. Before long, Marty was hooked, physically dependent on heroin. Nothing mattered but the ever-present craving for the drugs. He had given up interest in everything else.
I get no kick from champagne.
By the early 1950s, concern about marijuana was overshadowed by a new media scare, rising heroin addiction among teenagers who were drifting into crime to support their habit.
I want some money, old Sam.
But you're crazy.
The money!
I know you. They'd put you in jail.
Just get the money!
This heroin scare gave an aging anslinger a new way to attack marijuana and respond to anyone who might doubt its terrible danger. Smoking marijuana, he declared, was a direct stepping stone to heroin addiction.
Satan is real, working in spirit. You can see him and hear him in this world.
An individual then who tries the drug just for fun or experiments with it acts exactly like a person who loads the gun, puts a bullet in, puts it up to his head, very carefully, hopes for the best, and pulls the trigger.
Please stand by.
Teenage narcotic addiction. Is there an answer?
I have your name, please.
Robert M. Conlon, Commander of the Detective Bureau, Culver City Police Department, Culver City, California.
Is there any general personality traits that would apply to addicts?
Well, yes. Most of these addicts are very sick, and they are a menace and have to be arrested. I get a lot of self-satisfaction arresting those people.
And what about teenage addiction? How does that come about usually?
They start out by using marijuana.
And do most marijuana users finally go on the hard stuff?
Yes.
What kind of changes could be made to improve the narcotic situation based on present knowledge, Bob?
Well, Paul, the addict is a sick guy. And anything that could be done through legislation to make the penalty far greater, I am sure would be appreciated by every cop on every beat throughout the country.
Your name, please?
Harry J. Anslinger.
And your position and occupation?
Federal Commissioner of Narcotics.
Appearing at the Kefauver crime hearings, Anslinger backed Senator Hale Boggs' proposal to increase penalties for all drug offenses. Tougher penalties were needed, he said, because behind every narcotics peddler, there was a communist preparing to overthrow our government.
According
According to all the documents that we have been examining today, the major source is Red China.
Then do you see a marked increase in the amount of drugs circulating in this country which you believe come from Red China since China went communist in 1949?
Oh, very much so. And under the Nationalists, they had the situation pretty well under control. There were about 1,000 executions a year under the Nationalist Chinese government. I haven't heard of anyone being wounded under this regime.
Even though there was absolutely no proof of a communist plot to dope up America, the country was in the grip of Cold War hysteria, and no politician could afford to look soft on communism. Taking Anslinger's advice, President Truman signed the Boggs Act, which dramatically increased penalties for possession and ordered mandatory minimum sentences.
There's a considerable amount of heroin coming out of China.
Red China?
Red China, yes, sir.
On a roll now, Anslinger agitated for even tougher laws and got President Eisenhower to push them through Congress. The Narcotic Control Act put marijuana in the same category as heroin and made it subject to the same penalties. A first conviction for possession was punished with a mandatory prison term of 2 to 10 years. In addition, a number of states added their own penalties. In Missouri, a second conviction for possession could get you life.
This is Lieutenant McGee, Atlanta Police. This is Lieutenant McGee, the Atlanta Police Department. We got the stuff right away before the man had a chance to distribute it.
Do you think this stopped the entire operation?
Yes, sir. I'm sure of it.
Have you ever seen anything like it before?
No, sir. Not in my career. I haven't seen that much marijuana.
Okay, I'm going to get a different lens on you here. Is it sound pretty good?
Yeah.
Setting his sights higher, Anslinger went to the UN and used America's influence to persuade over 100 countries to consolidate their various drug agreements into a single, inflexible convention outlawing marijuana around the world. This was the ultimate achievement in Anslinger's relentless crusade to criminalize marijuana use.
Harry Jacob Anslinger, distinguished citizen, in your dedicated efforts to combat the illegal traffic in narcotic drugs, you have fashioned an effective organization to pursue this objective. Your noteworthy achievements in this field have earned for you the respect of the world community. Signed, John F. Kennedy.
In leaving the bureau he'd built up under 5 different presidents, Anslinger warned his successors of an impending drug revolution. Which he felt would be nothing less than an assault on the foundations of Western civilization.
Responsibility only to oneself.
life, liberty, and the pursuit of pleasure. The new Declaration of Independence for the teenager around the world. Smoke a joint, burn a little grass. Pot party, roach party, mainliner, skin popping, shoot some crystal. The language of the narcotic and marijuana user. The language of a large and ever-increasing number of teenagers. Starting in high school on benzodrine and dexedrine pep pills, it is not long before many soon graduate to marijuana. For some, it quickens sexual desire. For some, it is the release of sexual inhibitions. But whatever it is, teenagers are going for it. Maybe the forerunner of a new drug society out of some science fiction writer's imagination. Will drugs pave the road to destruction for the now generation?
Campuses across the country, a whole new generation discovered drugs. Rebellious and willing to experiment, they found they liked altering their consciousness.
Do you smoke pot?
Yes, I do.
Do you smoke marijuana?
Yes.
Do you smoke pot?
I've been smoking pot for about a year.
Have you found it addictive?
Oh, no. I go for months and months without smoking it, and then I'll smoke a lot, maybe in a week.
Well, the argument is made that pot leads to the addiction to heroin or other narcotics. Have you found this to be so among the people that you know?
No, not at all.
The people who use the stronger drugs, the opiates, etc., are not the people who smoke marijuana, and the people who smoke marijuana do not use the other drugs.
Gradually, the perception that marijuana was dangerous began to change. Many students saw smoking grass as a rejection of establishment values, a way of declaring their independence.
Over bridge of sights, to rest my eyes in shades of green, under dreaming spires. Ichiku Park, that's where I've been.
What did you do there?
I got high.
What did you feel there?
Well, I cried.
But why the tears there?
Tell you why. It's all too beautiful. It's all too beautiful. It's all too beautiful.
They all come out to groove about, be nice and have fun in the sun.
At this point, we are going to leave Golden Gate Park to go into the Haight Ashbury district of San Francisco. The last 18 months has seen a tremendous increase of the so-called hippies. This is a protest against the middle and upper class people of San Francisco, in fact, of the area. It is the belief of the people who live within the area that we, the middle class, have done a very, very poor job in running our government and our way of life.
This weekend, Jefferson Airplane on Friday, Grateful Dead on Saturday, the Carousel Ballroom, high above Market and Van Ness.
Anybody hungry?
Hey, how about we order some Chinese?
Order some Chinese to do what?
Federal Bureau of Narcotics, please hold. Federal Bureau of Narcotics, please hold. Federal Bureau of Narcotics, please hold.
The new head of the Federal Bureau of Narcotics, Henry Giordano, began to realize he had a problem. To address it, he developed a campaign he hoped would be believable to the younger generation. If you smoke marijuana, you will become an unmotivated, dysfunctional loser.
Pammy's on a bummer now, and nobody knows where she's at. She could be almost anywhere. Maybe someday she'll be mad. She started smoking pot.
If you become a pothead, you risk blowing the most important time of your life, your teenage. That unrepeatable time for you to grow up and to prepare for being an adult that can handle problems and make something meaningful out of life. Or you have the choice to have the courage to see and deal with the world for what it really is. Far, far from perfect, but for you and for me, the only one there.
Because so many were trying marijuana without any ill effects, the public demanded to know more. And for the first time, the federal government approved scientific testing.
The plain fact is that none of us know very much about this drug in any verifiable way.
Well, Bill, it's been about 2 hours since you got the drug. How do you feel?
Fantastic. Defiant? Not at all. Businesslike? Not at all. Sheesh. Friendly. Extreme. Since I sound ridiculous.
Would you be interested in taking part in a study like this again and having the same type of drug?
Sure.
You would. It's been a very pleasant experience for you.
I'll do it anytime you want.
Do you think it would be...
Any time at all.
Do you think
just
it would be...
Just call me any time of the day or night.
We found out that the drug makes people happy, it makes them intoxicated, and finally makes them sleepy, which is about what marijuana users were telling us happened all the time.
Hey, last call, folks. Drink it up. Oh, it's nice to see you, Bob. How's the wife, huh? Kids are okay? Good. That's fine. Let's drink to tomorrow. Hell, let's drink to tonight. Hell, let's drink.
It says right here that alcohol does more harm to your nervous system.
Stop reading that underground trash and pay more attention to your homework.
All that drivel they talk.
We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. We don't take our trips on LSD.
Whether the younger generation was presented as drugged-out hippies or anti-war protesters, conservative America reacted with a fear and hatred that threatened to pull the country apart.
Being free. I'm proud to be a from Muskogee. A place where even squares can have a ball. We still wave.
This is Fire Support Base Ares, 50 miles northeast of Saigon. Vito is a 20-year-old draftee from Philadelphia. A photographer before he entered the Army, Vito is now a squad leader, responsible for the lives of a dozen men.
Well, it's a 12-gauge shotgun. What we basically use it for on the LZ and I guess even out in the field, so if you want to know, is that we use the shotgun from a ball. You know, you just put the ball in a chamber and all. Paul, let me borrow that ball from you. I heard this is probably all SIDS and we're getting busted, but I don't care.
Shotgun.
What's happening here is also happening to some extent at virtually every other American installation in Vietnam. Recent surveys estimate that well over 50% of the soldiers in Vietnam use marijuana.
You get really stoned. Then, you know, who cares about the war?
this war.
It is time for an honest look at the problem of order in the United States. So I pledge to you, we shall have order in the United States.
Manipulating the fears of what he termed the silent majority, Richard Nixon built his campaign for the presidency around an emotionally charged central issue, restoring law and order. And it worked. As president, Nixon was determined to be seen as the toughest crime fighter ever. But most crimes fell under state jurisdiction, so Nixon wasn't allowed to get involved. However, there was one area where the federal government did have power: drug crime. Early in his first term, Nixon launched Operation Intercept, a military-style exercise officially described as the country's largest peacetime search and seizure operation. In it, 2,000 customs agents were deployed along the Mexican border. Their orders? Stop the marijuana.
This is the biggest mistake the government of the United States has made, and the biggest offense they have done to the Mexican people.
I think it's excellent. I think if it stops the marijuana flow in Los Angeles and the southern cities, I think it's excellent. If it doesn't, then I think our time is wasted.
Although more than 5 million American and Mexican citizens passed through this dragnet, practically no marijuana was intercepted. After 3 weeks, Operation Intercept was abandoned. Now, even more determined to appear tough on crime, Nixon poured federal money into equipping, training, and educating local police forces across America.
In the day-to-day conduct of your police duties, no matter how or for what reason you're called to investigate a situation in a residence, use your eyes to detect evidence of marijuana, hashish, or narcotic violations. The evidence you're looking for is here, all right. But it has to be located before you can read it. Use your eyes. Ashtrays are logical places to use your eyes for evidence of marijuana violations. There are some noticeable differences between a marijuana or grass joint and the butt of an ordinary cigarette, clearly visible even at a distance to those who use their eyes. This, of course, is marijuana itself, the best evidence of all. It has distinctive characteristics. Learn them. Use your eyes. It also has a distinctive aroma, so use your nose as well as your eyes.
Police officer, open the door.
As arrests skyrocketed, the convictions were no longer limited to minorities. Now most of the people serving time were white, middle-class American kids.
Why do you smoke marijuana?
It's really very simple. I smoke it because I enjoy it.
It doesn't worry you that you're breaking the law?
Sure, it worries me. I mean, it worries me because I don't want to get caught. I do not want to go to jail for something that I can consider a pleasure and harmless to both society and myself. I'm not hurting anybody. I'm not hurting myself. Why should I be punished for it?
And you may see me today with an illegal smile. It don't cost very much, but it lasts a long while. Won't you please tell the man I didn't kill anyone? No, I
John Crow was convicted of selling marijuana to an undercover agent, there seemed reason for hope. It was his first offense, after all, and the amount had been small, less than 1 ounce. But the jury saw its duty. Sentence, 50 years in prison. For Crow, 25 years old, newly returned from Vietnam, it was a bitter pill.
I had the feeling that I was fighting for my country and for my fellow man. And it is kind of depressing to know that I should come back and be given 50 years for allegedly selling some a lid of marijuana.
This is a Purple Heart that he received the first time that he was wounded.
There is a mother's pride as Mrs. Crow recounts Don's military record, but it is hard for her. He loved his country, she says. He was a good boy.
Well, we were naturally so proud of him when he was over there, and when he came back and all this happened, well, of course, I've just been heartbroken, and I think it is a little severe penalty.
I don't think that a kid should have their entire future career blighted by having an arrest record for being caught in a room where marijuana was kept, or for smoking a joint of marijuana when they're a kid in college or a young kid. And that's exactly what happens.
Everyone here seems to emphasize the kids. How can you communicate with them when they got flowers in their ears, where they can't hear, and hair down to their hip pockets?
The young person, other minority group members have a much greater chance of being arrested and are arrested. And if this continues, we're going to decimate the youthful population of America. That's exactly what's going to happen.
If any one of us has a kid who's arrested, it's going to be an arrest for a narcotic violation on his record for the rest of his life. He can't go in the Peace Corps, he can't teach school, he can't be a cop.
What's the difference if he committed murder or you have an arrest record?
Fine, if he committed murder, he's harmed someone.
Can any law be effective, especially a law dealing with marijuana, when there is so much controversy from so many eminent people?
No law can be effective that tries to regulate or legislate private morality. You can't make homosexual laws effective. You can't make... Could you pass a law that says it's a crime to masturbate? You couldn't enforce it. There's laws on the book that say thou shalt not fornicate either. And you wouldn't go around arresting kids for fornicating.
Well, I know you're law, would.
You don't even know it's against the law. You're a hell of a
law,
cop.
As a matter of fact. Sex is illegal in most of America.
Everything's illegal in America. It's illegal, immoral, or fattening. It's that simple.
I think we've come to somewhat of a conclusion here in that the law is not very effective.
No, it's not. How can it be effective when you have 10,000 kids in one city are being arrested in 1 year? The law is not effective.
As middle-class parents began asking, why is my kid in jail? More and more Americans began to feel that the problem was not marijuana, but marijuana laws. Support for reform of marijuana laws seemed to come from everywhere. Even federal officials agreed that harsh penalties were not working.
A conservative estimate of persons in the United States, both juvenile and adult, who have used marijuana at least once is about 8 million and may go as high as 12 million. Can you imagine what would happen to the law enforcement and correction system of this country if each of these 12 million people had been caught by a policeman when smoking his first marijuana cigarette? The first place in which legal reforms can be made is in the removal of mandatory minimum penalties in all cases of drug abuse.
Sensing the public's mood, Congress passed the Controlled Substances Act, which eliminated mandatory minimum sentences and reduced penalties for possession.
Is she dead?
Not yet. This picture was taken at 10 p.m. The girl lived until midnight. Any questions?
But I maintain the evidence against marijuana isn't in yet.
Well, sir, will you concede that it might be as harmful as alcohol?
Well, all right, but it's no worse.
No, sir, I hope not. Because according to U.S. government figures, between 5 and 6 million people in this country are physically and mentally sick as a result of their use of alcohol. If marijuana possesses only half the potential of alcohol for violence, criminality, accidents, and social degradation, do we need pot?
Unwilling to let a bunch of effete liberals ruin his crime-fighting agenda, Nixon enlisted TV producers and show business stars to send a strong moral message to every home, every school, and every church in America.
I've done a study of drug abuse, and I'm right in the middle of the whole thing, where I can do the most good.
Some people say that in a matter of months, Acapulco Gold will be available over the counter, menthol and king size, which is an indication of how little people know about marijuana. Today, research scientists are studying its effects on the brain, the nervous system, chromosomes, various organs of the body. Maybe it'll turn out there's no reason for it to be illegal. But nobody can be sure until all the facts are in. And until they are, it's a pretty bum risk.
Repelled by the idea of softening any laws, Nixon maintained that until more was known about marijuana's dangers, the laws should not change. To this end, he made millions of dollars available to find those dangers.
Many of us are concerned that a large percentage of our young people are breaking the law by smoking marijuana. As you know, your own White House conference youth voted to legalize marijuana. I know you've thought about this problem, and I wonder if you'd give us some of your thoughts on it.
Well, Mr. Pierpoint, as you know, there is a commission that is supposed to make recommendations to me about this subject.
The recommendation of the Commission in its first report is that we do not feel that private use or private possession in one's own home should have the stigma of criminalization, that people who experiment should not be criminalized for that particular behavior.
The Presidential Commission's report on marijuana found marijuana use in and of itself did not cause crime. Current laws against grass led to selective prosecution, and the police were suspected of using these laws to arrest people with objectionable hairstyles, skin color, or politics. The enormous cost of trying to enforce laws against marijuana overwhelmingly outweighed any deterrent value of these laws. The commission had conducted the most comprehensive and highly publicized study of marijuana ever done. Furious, Nixon tossed it in a wastebasket without ever reading it.
Mr. President?
Okay. Whenever you're ready. I shall continue to oppose efforts to legalize marijuana.
Doing the exact opposite of what was recommended, Nixon declared an all-out war on drugs. His primary weapon, the DEA, a new government agency that combined all of the government's existing anti-drug agencies into a single, all-powerful super agency.
Just keep going forward, to your right there. Looks like you're right on top of it.
Is that all there is?
Yeah.
Last week we pulled 13 pounds of it up in about five different patches, and we got another four or five now that are really small patches, but we're going to go ahead and pull them up today.
What do you do with this? You just come in and destroy the patch? Is that the idea?
We destroy the patch and then we'll take it and burn it.
Apparently there is somebody coming back here and cultivating.
Definitely. These are all in nice little neat rows. And it's kind of a rotating crop they've got. Some are smaller than others.
How good is Georgia pot?
I've never smoked it, so I don't know. One toke over the line, sweet Jesus. One toke over the line. Sitting
downtown in a railway station. One toke over the line. Employing more than 4,000 analysts and agents, the DEA had the authority to request wiretaps, enter private homes without knocking, and gather intelligence on ordinary citizens.
Shipley's still one toke over the line, and now Wadsworth Mansion smoking a little Sweet Mary.
Meanwhile, in suburbia, smoking pot had become the in thing for middle-class adults. Sort of like having a martini at happy hour.
Over a low to medium fire for about 5 minutes, stirring to avoid burning. Let it cool a few minutes, then grind it into a powder. Now you can do anything you want with it. Put it in ice cream, butter, milkshakes, jello, or put it in honey and freeze it into squares for later.
Until recently, the use of marijuana was considered a youth phenomenon, a thing of campus protests, the counterculture, long hair. Well, not so in the 70s. Meet some of the criminals at large.
I've spent a lot of time with my daughter and her friends, and they all smoked marijuana, and so I had to try it.
I first used pot back in the latter part of 1968, and have used it since then with some degree of regularity. I had some pot earlier today before I went down to court. I smoke at home, smoke at parties, in many places. To me, it's a question of the rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You know, who owns me?
Sign up here! You, over there! Come here!
As smoking marijuana became increasingly mainstream, pro-pot activists began organizing support for decriminalization.
Last year in this country, there were 226,000 marijuana-related arrests. And although the police sometimes tell us that they're only interested in the pusher or the seller, as they say, the fact is that only 7% of those arrests were against the seller. 93% of those arrests were for possession and use. Now, what that means is that there were about 200,000 young people in this country last year who were given an unnecessary criminal record and all that involved for the rest of their life simply because they smoked grass, something which is a relatively harmless thing to do. So we're not trying to encourage the use of the drug. In fact, we're trying to discourage it. But we're trying to get the country to understand that there are other means to discourage the use of drugs other than the criminal law. And in this case, the use of the criminal law causes more harm than the drug itself.
A political activist named John Sinclair became a symbol for the movement. He'd received a jail sentence of 10 for 2, 10 years in prison for possession of 2 joints.
This song I wrote for John Sinclair.
Consistent with the changing times, the city of Ann Arbor, Michigan passed an ordinance taking marijuana possession out of the criminal code and making it a minor offense, the equivalent of a parking ticket. year later, after a groundbreaking vote in its legislature, Oregon became the first state to completely decriminalize marijuana.
Here is a state that is not afraid to plow new ground in an area where there's a lot of hysteria. It's not going to be very widely understood. But I think as you look back over the handling of drugs, if you can keep it in for a few years, you'll see it was landmark legislation.
In 1974, with legal problems of his own, Richard Nixon resigned from the presidency.
The private possession and use and cultivation of marijuana.
A study in Oregon, 4 years after decriminalization, showed no increase in marijuana use and a substantial savings of tax dollars formerly spent on law enforcement. By that time, 10 other states had decriminalized marijuana. Continuing Nixon's war on drugs, fill-in President Gerald Ford ordered U.S. forces to spray Mexican marijuana fields with the military defoliant, paraquat. But in the upcoming presidential election, he found himself running against an unexpected opponent.
Appreciate your vote.
I do favor the decriminalization of marijuana.
Can our government be competent? Jimmy Carter says yes. Jimmy Carter says yes.
Tonight on Headline News, President Carter proposes major changes to federal drug laws.
I support a change in law to end federal criminal penalties for possession of up to 1 ounce of marijuana, leaving the states free to adopt whatever laws they wish concerning marijuana.
Due in part to advocacy by the decriminalization movement, the government was finally preparing to abandon its war on marijuana smokers.
But it's got some Labrador in it.
What's Labrador?
It's dog shit.
What?
Yeah, my dog ate my stash, man. So I had to follow him around a little baggie for 3 days before I got it back.
That's some heavy shit, man. Hey, man. Am I driving okay?
I think we're parked, man.
Well, all right, you squares. It's time you smoked. Everybody get high.
In the permissive 70s, marijuana seemed to be everywhere. Through movies and television, it had entered the popular culture.
The FBI claims that a huge shipment of grass, which they are calling killer dope, has been smuggled into New York City. The Bureau urges users not to smoke the weed, which is greenish brown in color, not particularly seedy, and contains mostly cannabis buds. Warning symptoms are a mild euphoria, a slight rise in the pulse rate, some hallucination, and death by laughter within 15 minutes of ingestion. In an effort to aid the FBI in its investigation, Weekend Update is undertaking its own analysis of marijuana sent to us anonymously by any viewers who may be worried. Simply place a small sample of the suspected cannabis in an envelope and send it immediately to Chevy Chase, Apartment 12, 827 West 81st Street, New York City, 10053.
But not everyone was laughing. Worried about teenage marijuana use, a number of concerned parents organized pressure groups to fight the new drug culture.
This is a dashboard pipe that fits onto the dashboard of your car so that you can put pot in here, and then the driver and his date can get stoned as they're tooling down the freeway. This is designed to put some pot in, and then you smoke the pot out of here. Now, you can toss a smoke to a friend if you want to. There are things like bongs, that's B-O-N-G. You put the pot here, light it, the smoke travels down here, collects, and then you get a concentrated volume of smoke by sucking in like this. And I think the label is instructive, bong, the only thing wasted is you. This too is a bong, it's called a power hitter. And it works by sticking a joint here and then blasting it into your lungs like this. Now it comes as a Star Wars space gun also.
Hello, Gary.
You put in boxes and bags.
Y'all gonna have to leave, I'm sorry.
And you are closed, officially closed, as of now.
Most of the afternoon was spent trying to decide what actually were head shops and drug-related paraphernalia. Managers and owners from head shops around the area testified that the law is now so ambiguous that possibly as much as 80% of their inventory could now be considered illegal. One owner admitted he may be out of work within the week. Most of the afternoon was spent trying to decide what actually were head shops and drug-related paraphernalia. Most of the afternoon was spent trying to decide what were head shops and drug-related paraphernalia. Owners and managers of head shops around.
In the midst of this backlash, Dr. Peter Bourne, Carter's chief drug policy advisor, was caught up in a scandal involving alleged cocaine use. As the press had a field day, the president could no longer afford to appear soft on drugs. His proposal to decriminalize marijuana would die in Congress.
And the perverts, and the liberals, and the leftists, and the communists coming out of the closets. It's time for God's people to come out of the closets, out of the churches, and change America. We must do it.
Driven by a sense of righteous indignation, the religious right mobilized into a potent political force. After a brief period of tolerance, America was poised for a major swing the other way.
Leading medical researchers are coming to the conclusion that marijuana, pot, grass, whatever you want to call it, is probably the most dangerous drug in the United States, and we haven't begun to find out all of the ill effects, but they are permanent ill effects. The loss of memory, for example.
This is your brain on drugs. Any questions?
Just say no.
Just say no.
In her crusade for a drug-free America, Mrs. Reagan led school
children... Are police officers in schools to spy on...
The president today ordered mandatory drug testing for all federal employees. He then called for the nation's industries to screen their...
The Supreme Court has given school principals the right to strip search any student suspected of drug possession.
Citing a threat to national security, the president today signed legislation allowing law enforcement agencies to seize property from the...
Under President George Bush's new zero-tolerance policy, marijuana is illegal.
Using illegal drugs is against the law. And when you're caught, you will be punished. Some think there won't be room for them in jail. We'll make room. The rules have changed.
In a speech to the Coast Guard today, George Bush said that drug trafficking should be grounds for the death penalty.
I'm proposing a quarter of $1 billion, $8 billion, the largest increase in history.
Since President Clinton took office, over 3 million people have been arrested for possession of marijuana, more than under any previous administration. The United States government continues to wage a war on grass that, time and time again, has proven itself misguided and completely ineffective.
That being so, the orderly thing to do under our form of government is to abolish a law which cannot be enforced, a law which the people of the country do not want enforced.
Soothe me with your caress, sweet marijuana, marijuana. Help me in my distress, sweet marijuana. You alone can bring my lover back to me. Even though I know it's all a fantasy. And then put me to sleep. Sweet marijuana, marijuana.
They can get loaded, they can get stoned.
57% of the student body was smoking pot. Smoking pot, pot, pot. It fascinates and then assassinates and then it kills. A drug epidemic that's sweeping our nation. We need to legalize pot, pot.
Man, I didn't dig that.
What you see and hear in this picture will keep one of you, only one person, from taking that first step. Our purpose has been accomplished, and we are humbly thankful.